This is John Mckay, the writer and director of the film.
And this is Lee Thomas, the producer.
And there's the beginning of Kevin Sargent's score. That went through lots of different versions, didn't it? We thought for a while it was going to sound like the American Beauty score.
Yeah.
With lots of marimbas. But in the end we opted for English with oboes and violins.
To say I'm disappointed, young lady, is an understatement. I mean, here you
now you can start taking the mick out of me, Lee, because I think the beginning of the film is influenced by the very opening of Raise the Red Lantern by Zhang Yimou.
Is that right? There are no tears, though, in this.
I tried to get this girl to cry, but she wouldn't do it.
Gong Li cries in that film. The thing I think you... This always struck me about this scene is that you allowed the girl to have her hands in her pockets, and I just don't buy that she would have got away with that, really.
If you're going to be criticising me all the way through my movie, you can stop now. There we are. Andy McDowell smokes, and I have to say that Andy McDowell is a world championship smoker.
Yeah, she did revel in the opportunity to work in England in a film where everyone smokes.
I think she's not allowed to smoke in American movies. But she does smoke all over this film. Here's Imelda Staunton.
You see,
she was the easiest one to cast, I think.
Yeah, she was, yeah.
It's like when we started out before making the movie and we had the three big female roles to cast, Imelda came to mind right away, and so we offered it to her, and bang, she said yes, she was on it for ages. Actually, she's got a black eye in this scene because this was a reshoot, and in between the main shoot and this one, she'd had an accident, run into a door or something. And usually people don't notice, but now I've told you, I guess you could spot that.
Yeah, because we shot this in the January 2001, didn't we? Sort of 5 months later than most of the movie.
Yeah, this scene was completely shot out of sequence. Because we made some changes to the movie after shooting it and cutting it for the first time. And among the changes were early scenes to set later scenes up better. Mm.
This used to be a scene where a young boy had stolen a golf, and it was just set up that Imelda Staunton was there as the compassionate police officer with a heart. But we needed that to work differently for what comes later in the film.
Yeah, that's right.
And we learned all about that through market testing, didn't we? We took the film out twice to Hatfield with a raw audience and questionnaire about
the
film.
They are very raw in Hatfield, believe me. Here's Anna Chancellor, who always gets cast as sort of femme fatale, I think. And I think Anna's secretly a romantic heroine, so we kind of got her to play against type here. I think she turns out fairly romantic in the end. Everyone always says, whose house is that? Can I buy it? So if you're interested, it's a house at Snow Hill in the Cotswolds, near Chipping Camden.
I'm not sure if you used to say that.
What?
I'm not sure if you're allowed to say that.
Well, we can cut it out. When we were building the set for Andy McDowell's house here, the designer, Amanda MacArthur, showed me the drawings of the set, and I liked it very much. Because I wanted a kind of a look-through like you have in Woody Allen films, in the apartments you have there. It's great for comedy because you can see people in the foreground and the background, and you can do chat. But I kept asking for it to be bigger and bigger until in the end we ran out of space in the studio.
And money, nearly. Yeah, I remember a conversation with Fiona, I think, and she said, oh, Amanda's been down today, we're just going over the budget, and floor plan keeps expanding by inches, by inches, by inches, as you and Henry work out that you need a bit more space.
We eventually had a very big set, but very few dressings and props. So we used to move the props around depending on where the shot was and bunch them all into the corner, which was the background for that particular shot. He says, "What about meeting?" Do you remember this guy?
Yeah.
We had to cast a kind of unlikely date for Molly. And this guy wandered in, and he looked so much like George Clooney that we cast him. This is Stravinsky's Rite of Spring, the one of many musical jokes in the film that me and about three people get.
Tell me about, because music was very from the very early script stage, music was really important. And tell us a bit about your choices. And we didn't end up with your favourite choices because of money restraints in the end. But
When you write and direct a film, you also want to be a DJ and play everyone your favourite music tracks. So I wrote a lot of music to play into the film. And there's a joke that Molly gives in a few moments about how Kate, the Andy McDowell character, has the wrong soundtrack on her movie, which is something that somebody used to say to me, that was that I had the wrong soundtrack on my movie because I was being melancholic all the time. And originally the movie was going to have a lot of early 70s folk rock on it. And I'd imagine people like James Taylor and Joni Mitchell and Carole King. But the reality of making a low-budget British movie is that all those people charge too much money for their tracks. So we wound up with alternatives and more modern music on the film.
And how much did Tonic's wafers slip you to include that in the film?
It does seem like a major sponsorship deal that Tonic's wafers are so prominently featured in the film. But in actual fact, they gave us sweet FA.
I know. But what did they give you?
A lifetime supply in my backyard.
It started out as a chocolate orange as well, didn't it?
Yeah, the women needed a kind of a prize for their sad storytelling competition. And for a while it was a chocolate orange. And then Terry's Chocolate Orange began to do a campaign on TV with Dawn French, which was not a million miles away from the kind of theme of women and chocolate and sadness. So I just thought it had been done too much.
This might be a good time to talk about the original title of the film, because we have the three women getting together for their club. And the film was once called The Sad Fuckers Club, which was a great title, particularly in development. But it just didn't stick. Do you want to say something about that?
Well,
where the name came from?
Yeah, for a long time it was called the Sad Fuckers Club, because these three women get together and tell stories in order to determine who is the saddest fucker of the week. When the script had that title on the front page, it used to leap out of the development pile of various financiers. People always remembered it, which is very useful for propelling it into finance and production. And the title originally came from a group of friends I used to know who were women doctors who called themselves the Sad Fuckers Club, because every Friday they didn't have dates. They were too busy working to get themselves a boyfriend, and they used to drink wine and smoke cigarettes, as doctors do, of course, and eat chocolate and generally unhealthy food, and decide who was the saddest of the week. And actually, the prize that they had was that they had a particularly tatty crocheted blanket that you were allowed to lie under if you were the saddest. And they called it the ME blanket, because if you had ME, as far as doctors are concerned, you really are neurotic and sad. I remember when we were shooting this scene out in the woods in the Cotswolds. It was the night of the great disaster, wasn't it? We went through two or three generator trucks.
Yeah.
That particular night, and were saved by Henry Braham, the cameraman, who knew how to drive a JCB.
Yeah.
And he went to borrow one from a local farmer and towed the generator truck off of the narrow track where it wedged between two trees.
It was quite an evening. I think one of the stunt drivers nearly hit one of our crew as well on
That's
a skid
right.
in the mud because of the rain.
And we had a swanky car, which was meant to be Imelda Staunton's car, and our highly trained stunt driver put it into a wall.
It was an expensive evening.
It was.
This isn't a man's story, is it? This is a general story, and you know that general stories don't count. I was thinking of buying a present.
This is a scene where Andy McDowell goes into a shop, and after a while in the production, Andy used to say to me, "So what are we shooting today? Are there any shops involved?" Because one thing that Andy really likes is shopping, so we used to think up more scenes to get her out and shopping.
And this is one of the few scenes actually shot in London, in London locations, wasn't it?
There's a little toy shop there. Everyone always thinks that we put these baby magazines into the shot here.
But they were there,
we didn't. No. And that's as far as that story goes. this is my life at home. So that's why I put it in a movie.
You're not that good looking.
Thanks.
Did you enjoy working with Andy?
Yeah, I thought she was great. She's terribly hardworking and devoted person. I think before this movie, she'd very often been cast as the girlfriend or the wife or the kind of light decorative interest, and she saw a chance in this movie to play some other things, to play loneliness and sadness and kind of comic desperation, and she really went for it, I think. I really admire her for that.
Oh, gosh, I just don't know what to order.
Here's musical joke number two, the difference between Stravinsky and Delius.
Look.
I was struck how easy it was to work with Andy McDowell because, you know, this was our first film and I was very wary of working with what for us was a big star. And you hear nightmare stories about what it can be like, you know, coming with a British budget of about £4.5 million when working with people that are used to much bigger budgets and much bigger resources to play with. And it actually was a real pleasant surprise. She was so easy to work with. And everyone just mucked in as a team, really.
I expected a lot of trailer behaviour, I think, in advance. You know, that because she was a big star, she would spend a long time in her trailer with hair and makeup and costumes and all that kind of thing. But Andy was almost always the first on the set. She's fairly dangerous in the car as well. I remember she used to drive this Volvo very fast.
God, you remember that? I remember a man, we had a company that was getting cars for us and they kept bringing the wrong car, and the designer, Amanda MacArthur, was asking for a particular colour, this colour in fact, and on the day of the shoot they turned up with a red car. So she said, this is no good, and she grabbed a man in the street in Chipping Camden and said, can we use your car for the film? And he said, yeah, all right then. And we gave him the car that had been brought to us as the hire car, as it were, and that was a little slip up that we narrowly escaped.
It's funny the way things work out in films like that. Very often you get the best things off of passers-by instead of off the people you're paying thousands of pounds to solve problems.
People might want to know, this is not, I can't remember the name of this building, but it's not a school. It was just an empty building that we dressed.
Yeah, it's an Edwardian country house near Morton in the Marsh. It's quite famous for an arboretum that it's got, and we redressed it as a school. Everyone thinks it's a very posh private school because the building's so posh. And this is the sort of neighbourhood crematorium, which is actually Brompton Oratory in London.
We have come together today to pay tribute to a leading member.
There's Bill Paterson, who's a great Scots actor, who I had to cram into the movie somehow. He's terrific, Bill, because you'll never meet a cheerier person. If the entire crew's been rained on for 48 hours and Bill turns up on set, he'll have them laughing in five minutes.
Funny guy.
First sight of Kenny Doughty. His little fluffy head from behind.
With broad shoulders.
We spent a long time looking for a boy, didn't we?
We did. We must have looked at... how many? 50, 60?
Yeah, a lot of boys. We kept being sent various young, handsome boys by our casting director, and I think we were very keen that we didn't want a posh boy. And the trouble is that most young male actors turn out of drama school having lost their original regional accent or individuality. And after a while, Kenny wandered in, and he looked like a little flyweight boxer or something. He looked like he'd been in trouble, but like he had the soul of a poet or something.
Yeah.
Remember, we did a sort of swing test on him. We had a casting tape and we showed it to various women.
Yeah.
And he scored very highly. And I have to say, continues to score very highly.
He does.
Which is why I don't like walking into a party with Kenny Doughty. This boy meets girl set up here with Andy and Kenny in two fairly loose shots. I mean, they're singles, but they're loose and static rather than bang in for a big close-up like you might expect. Mm. He's actually nicked from Annie Hall. There's a scene where Woody Allen first meets Diane Keaton at a tennis club, and Gordon Willis in that movie holds the shots very loose, and there's something that happens in a significant moment where you, the people you want to meet, meet. If you restrain the camera, then the audience feels the impact of it often more than if you did an obvious move in or some sort of cheap move. And then, of course, they're shagging in the graveyard.
Yeah.
Do you remember when we shot this? I mean, it looks quite fun on screen, but it was kind of nearly hailing out of grey skies overhead, and there'd be about 30 or 40 crew standing around, and Concorde descending towards Heathrow. Oh, yeah, you know, it's nothing but pleasure and glamour in the film industry.
I don't think I was around that day, actually. I mean, I was around, but I wasn't on set for this scene.
Yeah?
Probably I saw the weather report and thought, I really need to be there. Me.
You'd be off swanning around in your limo and smoking your cigar, Mr. Right. Producer.
That's right.
People sometimes ask, why is there a country dance scene in this movie, given that it's set in Middle England in the Cotswolds? And do you remember we, initially this scene, the action of this scene was set for a balloon.
Yeah, exactly.
That the three girls were going to go on a special sort of outing, and we were actually going to shoot in a balloon up in the air and all that kind of thing.
With a helicopter. But we had to have the actresses in the balloon because we wanted realism.
Yeah, it was going to be very authentic. And one way or another, it was kind of explained to us that there was... You know, there was no way that that three very valuable actresses were going to ascend in a balloon with a camera.
Yeah. Insurance or no insurance.
That's right. But, you know, give me three or four movies' time, you know, I'm gonna get Tom Cruise and Gwyneth Paltrow in a balloon.
I think I had sex with a
25. So I fell back on the one thing I had specialist knowledge of, which is awful Scottish country dancing. And we found these Scottish country dance enthusiasts who were brilliant. They taught Andy McDowell and co how to Scottish country dance, and then they watched everyone fall over. We had stunt dancers as well, didn't we?
We did. Padded up. I think what was funny about shooting that scene as well was that it was actually shot in silence.
Yeah.
And we had to get the beat going, so someone would be going dum, 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 dum. And then they did this whole thing without music. It was very interesting.
It's always that way when you're shooting dance or music scenes on film, is that for some god-awful sound reason, you're never allowed to actually have the music. Mm. And which is why I think that disco scenes look so terrible on film, because you get a lot of extras who don't know what they're dancing to.
Yeah.
This scene here, walking along the street in Chipping Campden, was probably influenced by Woody Allen as well, because he always has scenes where people are walking along the street and talking. So we put the camera on a steady cam and just kind of pulled ahead of them. But the thing I discovered after making the scene and getting it back into the editing room is that Woody Allen must put everyone in soft training shoes. Because these girls were still in their heels, and if you listen to the original soundtrack, all you can hear is click, 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 click,
yeah.
Click, click.
Didn't think of that.
Yeah, well, think about it next time.
There's something about Chipping Campden as well that sort of set the tone for the colour of the film, didn't it, really? It took a long time to find that consistent look. And then I've had some feedback that the film looks quite expensive, and I think it's to do with the way you worked with designer and Henry Braham too. Keep the palette tight, colour palette tight.
Yeah, there's a terrible thing, colour in films. It's because there are, you know, 360 million colours in the world, and if you don't watch what you're putting in front of the camera, it'll just look a mess. So what I like to do is I like to limit the number of colours that are going in front of the camera. And when you look at most little English county towns now, they're they can be quite pretty, but they're already gone to pot. You know, you've got a little bit of thatch, a little bit of stone, and suddenly a great big branch of boots or etam in the middle of them. Whereas we found this little township in Camden that was still very much all one colour, honey-coloured stone, and that kind of dictated a sort of brownish gold palette for the film.
And you've been experiencing sudden pain.
I love this this movie. I love this scene. I just love the way that Henry shot it with light coming through the blinds. It's one of my favourite scenes to look at in the film. If I had my way, there'd be more scenes like this in the film.
Thinking that I have another cyst.
Well, I have to say that is bollocks because your ultrasound.
Say more about that.
Completely
clear. The light.
Yeah, I just like the way the light comes through the blinds. And the way that the characters are sort of lit from the side and lit behind as well. There's a tendency in comedy to light everyone from the front. You know, if you look at an Austin Powers movie, nobody's ever in shadow.
Sure.
Because the producer and director are worried that if you can't see their eyes, it won't be funny.
Yeah.
Whereas I think there's room in a movie like this, which is a comic but also a drama, for scenes that are a bit more moody.
Actually, whether this film is a dramatic comedy or comic drama or is one of the has been one of the ongoing discussions, hasn't it, in terms of how best to pitch this film. So anyone watching who's expecting a complete, full-out comedy might get some surprises, and quite the reverse.
Yeah, I'm afraid I'm far too gloomy a person to have an out-and-out comedy. You have to have some heartbreak and trouble in the middle for me. Some people can't take the scene, can they?
No, they get all spooky and spooky, but I guess we know it's not the real thing, so...
Yes. Even though much of it was shot in a crypt.
Yeah.
Whether it's a comedy or a drama or whatever, there's always a big pressure on from film financiers, the guys who give you the money. It's going to be a funny movie, isn't it? Yeah, we can see it. It's the funniest movie.
Yeah, we can sell that.
Yeah, because I guess comedy shifts more units. I like comedies where you understand that things are funny because life can also be sad. And some critics couldn't get their mind around that because they thought that the movie shifted tone. They thought that it should either have been one thing or the other. And I guess I've learned my lesson about that, but I'm still fairly unapologetic that I like movies where you get a bit of everything.
And once you're sorted for that, you start to look around. And suddenly they realise there's a coffin up front. And you don't want them thinking putrefaction or...
Kenny Doughty had piano lessons, didn't he, in order to be able to do these organ scenes. And it's difficult to get an actor who doesn't play the keyboard at all to completely, you know, play by the time you're shooting. So what we told him to do was to learn to look like he can play the keyboard. And Kenny understood that very well. So he sort of learned the mime of it.
With scenes like this, though, you always wonder, can he really play? Don't you? Everyone's asking the question.
Yeah, I think the trick of it is to include as many shots as possible of his real hands on the real keyboard. And if you do that a few times, people sort of relax and buy it. It's when there's a cut between the maestro's face and a pair of hands.
So there's a cut just now and that wasn't his hands, wasn't it?
No, it's all it's all his hands up to now.
Really? I thought they were the...
The false hands.
The false hands.
The rubber hands that we
used.
Not
the animatronic hands that we spent £10,000 making.
No, I think it's all his hands so far. There's about to be one where it's not his hands.
Ah.
This whole scene was based on a documentary,
yeah.
Wasn't it?
Yeah.
I saw this documentary about a guy who used to play at funerals, and he had a little speech like this where he said, you know, I'm here to help people cry. Mm. And what I do is I play these chords at the beginning and that puts you in the mood, and then play these chords halfway through and that gets you off, and I play these chords in the end to let you dry your nose.
Which might be a good point to mention, when originally the script was, it was originally based on a play you wrote, but the character of Jed was in fact a road protester, swampy type character. And there was whole chunks of the film were set in forests up trees, weren't they, at one point. But the film 4 had a head change of head, and from David Hawkins' reign to Paul Webster's, and they said, well, we love the film, love the characters, love the title, but we don't like this character's job description, so come up with something else, and you came up with it, with the funeral organist.
Yeah, originally he was Jed was trouble in more ways than one. I think in the eventual movie here, he's trouble because he's young, simply. And originally he was trouble because he was a sort of rebellious character as well. And the most rebellious characters at that point, and I guess the least likely for a respectable headmistress to have an affair with, were sort of eco-protesters. But one of the executives on the film, fairly reasonably, I think, pointed out that nobody wants to sleep with an eco-protester.
Because Kenji needs all their money for recording his new album.
Ah, the of course, you're a fluent Japanese speaker, aren't you, Lee? And we feel your influence in this scene.
That's right.
With the inclusion of a Japanese person. Didn't you find us that guy?
I think I found him through, yeah, through... to Mommy, my wife.
Is he still? We used to have more of this Brendan character, the son. He's very good, I think, though running time meant that we sort of cut to the plot a bit in the eventual cut. I thought he was very good as a sulky teenager.
Yeah, he was very good. I love this. I love Anna Chancellor in this scene. She's very funny. She really plays it. The comic timing is great in this.
Mm, yeah, because she pursues the truth.
Yeah. Really? Just you look like something's happened.
Are you being completely honest? This is a this is meant to be Janine's house in the Cotswolds, though it's actually a house in Notting Hill that belongs to the Branson family. And I don't mean Branson Pickle. I mean Branson Trains and Planes.
I can smell man on you. Well, there was this one guy.
I knew it.
Okay, well, come on, what's going on? Where? Come on.
At work, teacher.
Gosh, that's amazing, seeing as you work at a school and everything. I mean,
so this screen that where everyone's watching is very flat and squished and long.
You mean the shape of the picture?
Yeah. How did... I remember opposing it a little bit in the beginning, or at least the original desire, because I was a bit worried that we were just trying to... I don't know.
Be flash,
for flash's sake. But I think
because cinema's not
very,
a flash medium, is it?
Not really.
No,
not where I come from. But it was well thought out and paid off in the end for lots of these scenes in which three women are talking. So it was Henry Braham sort of brought the anamorphic touch with you.
Yeah, anamorphic is a particular sort of set of lenses that you use on the camera to get this sort of squished out long letterbox shape of picture. And it's the kind of shape that they used for Star Wars and Sergio Leone movies, and tends to be used on big spectacle movies. But I was looking for some way that I could get three women in a row on screen without them seeming all squashed up, and it presented itself for that. But in actual fact, we got a lot of bonuses out of it, where it's great for. It's great for close-ups in a way that's hard to explain why a long letterbox should be good for showing the human face. It's also very good for landscape because you get a lot of view in it. And I think it's part of how we got a more classy look for the film than the money might have bought us.
Does it have a narrow depth of field, so the background falls away very quickly, so you have sort of slightly out-of-focus feel around the character.
Yeah. It's exactly so. Blurry front, blurry back. I'm going to say that again. Blurry front, blurry back, and the middle where the character is sharp. Looks kind of poetic.
The big laugh.
Yeah, people really like that.
There's nowhere in the world that we've happened to have watched this film where people haven't laughed.
That's the international language of jigging someone's bum.
Yeah.
But the strange thing is that you need to know who's who in the movie before you laugh at it. Like we tried, we all thought this is a great moment. We've got to put this in the trailer. But if you put it in out of context, where a woman grabs a guy's bum, it's not funny. It's just so.
Yeah, it's the mistaken identity that's funny.
Yes. All right. This is Jeff. Having said that, I think This is one of the scenes in the movie that I shot worst. I think I should go back to director's school and spend time in detention for the way I shot this scene. My organs
at your service whenever. How would you do it differently?
I would have more close-ups, and I'd be more in the line of sight for Jed and Kate, so that we'd be more onto their faces.
Right.
It's a bit too much. Group of three.
Mm.
So you're a bit cool on it. Here's Broadway Tower on the edge of the Cotswolds, looking down over the Vale of Evesham.
So, I know. Chilly up there, wasn't it?
It was really cold. Andy McDowell is not acting at this point. It's all in the mind. If you think safe, it really would freeze your nuts off.
There's a very tiny, narrow stone staircase to lug all the equipment up.
And yeah,
I felt very sorry for the
techs and the sparks.
Gaffers and the sparks. Yeah,
they looked at me like I was mad. We had a lot of help from a lot of kids in this movie, didn't we? Because she's a school teacher. We sort of needed school children all the time, and they did really well, I think. You know, people are very willing to help, and if I don't ever get another chance, I'd like to say thank you to all the schools and school children who helped us out in this movie.
Absolutely. They look like they've been doing it for ages through drama. They look like they're from drama school, a lot of these kids.
Yeah, no, they were just, they just kids from local schools, weren't they? Anyway, he's very sweet. It's very hard to get to shoot in a supermarket, isn't it? Supermarkets are always open.
Yeah.
So it's really hard to get one to shoot in.
Oh, there's me, walking there with the blue.
Were you there?
Yeah, that was me. Don't worry about that.
Shall we rewind and get that again?
No, then? I don't think anyone need bother about it, but... My one tiny cameo, which I've now been edged out of shot. They promised me I was in shot, but in the left-hand corner... Oh, anyway, let's move on.
No, I want to talk about that some more. This is a beautiful house, this one. Again, it's meant to be in the Cotswolds, but actually, we shot it in London. It's this beautiful, pristine house where the woman who owned the house didn't just live, she also showed art.
I love the way you... This is one of my favourite... scenes, and I love the way you just left the camera there, teasing us.
What, the door?
Yeah, and you didn't, you know, they ran up the stairs, they come back, and we're just left here wondering what's going on. And, you know, you don't get too fussy with where the camera ought to be to see all the action.
Yeah. I'm going to reveal an influence here that I think this scene and the way I shot it was very much influenced by this filmmaker in the 30s, Ernst Lubitsch, who shot MGM Hollywood comedies. And he used very, very simple camera actions. And he would show you a door, and you would know exactly what kind of naughty business was going on behind it. Mm. And somehow you found that even naughtier than seeing whatever it was, because you were using your imagination. He also had very stylish interiors like this. Here we go.
Wait, hey.
I like the pizza boxes in that scene. There's something about the pizza boxes that make that scene funny.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it would be all right to be caught with someone up your arse without pizza boxes, but with the pizza boxes, how awful! Little bit of symbolism there, yeah.
Hey.
Well, you got to use every means.
And this is a scene shot quite differently from the rest. Why was that?
Well...
Handheld, flowing...
Yeah.
It was
the end of the day. We had about an hour to get this scene, which is not long in film terms, and a very small room to shoot it in. And I said, I know what we're going to do, thinking on my feet. We're going to shoot it handheld, so we won't have to do lots of individual shots that will take a lot of time. And the cameraman and his operator, who actually moves the camera, looked at me and said, "Now, you're not just doing this because we're hurried, because they don't believe in time, cameramen. They say, no, we'll stay till 10 o'clock. And, of course, I know that costs a lot of money and causes a lot of trouble. So I said, no, I really believe, for the spirit of the scene, it's a lively scene, we can do it handheld, like Husbands and Wives, another Woody Allen movie where there's a lot of chat and a lot of handheld camera. And essentially I was winging it. I think it does suit the scene in the end. I think it was a lucky chance.
Actually, in terms of the camera work, we were lucky this time to be working with a DOP, director of photography, who's, you know, Henry Brehm is mainly concerned with lighting and, of course, the overall photography. But we had a camera operator, Kate Robinson, extremely talented. And but we're used to from film school and whatnot, just having one person doing the whole lot, because you can't afford that luxury of two people in the camera department at that level.
Yeah.
What was that like working that way?
It's good, I think. I mean, you know, it's one more voice in the debate about what you should do, which can be time-consuming sometimes. But in the end, when the team knits up and you all start to think as one, there's nothing like it, because, as you say, when you've got a cameraman who's both operating the camera, so laying the track and working out the moves, plus planning the lighting and talking to the lighting team, it's too many jobs, you know. It's like trying to be a policeman and a doctor at the same time. Lots of careful arrangement of a sheet for that scene.
Come on.
They talk about the L-shaped sheet, don't they, for bed scenes in films.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, where people in films sleep under an L-shaped sheet, where the woman has the top of the L and the guy has the kind of lower bar of the L.
Right, right. Fit, 45-year-old.
I like this scene. I like the way that Molly is scornful of the guy who's just had a heart attack.
Yeah.
That's based on anyone I ever knew who was a doctor, because essentially they hate their patients' doctors. They see them as scum.
What?
Hello, Molly, it's Kate.
Andy McDowell was very keen that we should, you know, be a bit more racy in the film, because initially been very sort of modest in the sex scenes. There's not really very much nudity in the film. Andy thought, we could go a bit further. And so one day on set, we found this little art postcard of an old Dutch painting, which showed a woman from behind looking in a mirror like this. And she said, we could do a scene like that. So I thought, if Andy McDowell's telling you can do a scene like that, you better do a scene like that.
This three-way conversation scene was a bugger to edit, wasn't it?
Yeah, really hard to get the rhythm right for it.
Because it's playing with time. Of course, she's not speaking to two friends at once. But you're presenting the idea as, you know, one consistent timeline in a way.
Yes. I think that it's hard sometimes when you're editing to get those things right, but that audiences are surprisingly literate and flexible about the way they read film. Because our notion of time and montage has been so mixed up by 100 years of film, plus pop video. You know, we'll accept images in almost any impressionistic order now. The thing you want to watch out for is you don't want to pop out of the film. That's not cheap, is it? Getting Kenny to take his top off.
Get his personal trainer for that 3 months intensive before the filming.
Yeah, I must get a personal trainer.
Yeah, I could do it right now. I've got a two-pack. I'd like one of those 6-packs.
Yeah.
Don't let me keep you.
That's not real wine, of course. What sort of... It wasn't Ribena, was it?
I don't know what they use, but you're not allowed real alcohol on a film set. It's not quite the party that everyone thinks it is. No. Good to get the Archers theme into a movie, I think. You know, it's not used in films often enough.
Oh, look at this.
I like this scene. I like this scene because of what Imelda does. Imelda Staunton is actually a one-woman show, if you ever get her on her own. You know, she just... goes, and she did such great things, I think, in this scene with the dresses and everything. Great business.
Dad, where'd you get that?
He picked it out. Oh, he picked out all of these. Oh, they're
good. In a moment, there's a gag where Andy whispers something dirty to her, and her reaction's just great.
I've not ever seen myself being dirty, don't
you? Oh, I don't know about that.
Oh, naughty boy.
Listen, there's these old blokes at the door.
Old what? Oh! No, that'll be the men.
And I can't have any more conversations about...
The funny thing was that we were shooting this scene in high summer. This was about July by the time we were shooting this. And it was one of the coldest nights. These people were all freezing.
But they were like moths the size of... Small shoes.
Yes, there were. There were small shoes flying through the air everywhere. It was lit with an enormous kind of globe light, like one of those old Habitat Chinese lanterns, that gives a kind of soft moonlighty light from above. And by the end of 2 or 3 hours shooting, this thing was covered with the world population of moths.
This was a tricky scene to get right, even from the script stage, in that we, you know, you wanted this character, Jed, to be a little bit, you know, almost appalled by the formality and pompousness of the of the other blokes in the in this sort of formal dinner party.
Yeah.
And you wanted to sort of reveal his rebelliousness by having slurping his soup, but you didn't want to. I remember we sort of were debating how much grossness can you have with a guy without you know, losing sympathy with him and wondering why he would show up, Andy, you know, the Andy McDowell character, Kate. And it often comes down to personal taste, doesn't it, as to...
Yeah, I was always pretty clear that he could be very cheeky and actually quite badly behaved if we cast a charming guy. I think it comes down to charm.
Yeah.
I think also maybe there's something about men and women, in that if you sit a man down in front of a film, like in The Full Monty, for instance, men quite like the often quite boorish behaviour of the guys in The Full Monty, whereas a woman would like different bits. She wouldn't like the boorish bits so much. You know, I think women often go for different things. So there was a kind of fine balance of taste here about how to represent his unsuitability. You know, I think that Jed's character is essentially he's an angel in disguise. You know, there's something ostensibly very wrong about him, in that he seems young and a bit shiftless. You know, he doesn't have a decent job or anything. But essentially everything else is right about him. You know, he's beautiful and he loves her. People sometimes ask, why does Molly do what she does? And I think that part of it is that she's jealous. You know, she's meant to be the sexy, vampish one out of this trio. And friends often don't like when roles shift, you know. Oh, I thought you were my sad friend. I don't like it now. You've got a great boyfriend. But I think she's also quite possessive of Kate, the Andy McDowell character, and drives her a bit nutty.
He's had a dose. What? NSU, the clap is...
That shot just now, the exterior of this doctor's surgery, reminds me of how useful some of the digital technology was in getting some of the shots in the film. So that was shot during the day, that particular shot, and we went to...
Yeah, we, for one reason or another, we either missed or we couldn't afford to go back for a night shot of the surgery. But these days, without, you know, being a digital effects film like The Matrix or something, you can often get yourself lots of little useful shots by going to a digital effects house afterwards and getting them to treat them. So that was a day shot, which wound up being night. And I think if you looked at it for a long time, you'd think there's something a bit funny about that shot, but it just passes in a moment. There's a couple of those in the film.
I think there are about 15 digital effect shots, you know, including zoom-ins and pans and night for day, day for night.
And the volcano exploding later on, of course.
The volcano, yeah.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. Have you got a printer?
I always worry if the car's going to blow up when he smokes.
It's funny, you do worry about that kind of thing, don't you? It never occurred to me at the time. Because, you know, I mean, quite a lot of guys work on motors and they smoke at the same time.
Yeah, all that oil, John.
Why wouldn't I be? God, I'm headmistress of a school.
All right.
I'm supposed to be a moral...
We'd been doing interiors for what seemed like months up until this scene. Suddenly, we got outside and it was very sunny and hot. And at the beginning of the day, everyone was so happy to be outside because it was beautiful and sunny. And within about an hour, everyone had sunburn. It was like we'd forgotten what sun does to you, apart from these two who had to stand out in it.
And I remember this is one of those days where I didn't help, because we had some visitors on set for the first time. They were, I think, our Is it future, not publicists, but marketing campaign people. And they were just visiting to get a feel for the film. They'd obviously read the script.
Yeah.
And, you know, just wanted to see what was going on. And I marched them onto set and didn't realize that they were sort of spooking the actors. Because they're, I suppose, you know, you build up a, over a period of weeks, you build up relationships and you get used to each other and it's like a family, and then it's easy for actors to do their work in a self, in a non-self-conscious way. But when you bring new people on, it, it's like racehorses, they get spooked very easily.
Yeah.
And I wasn't really aware of that, you know, how much of an impact it would have. And I think it took about 10 takes more than usual to get that out of Andy.
Yeah, what you can't tell in the scene is that there are a bunch of fashionistas standing in a bush nearby. This assembly scene was probably the only scene which survived from the original play that I wrote about 7 or 8 years before making the movie. There was a scene in the play where the then headmistress character let the children go.
You do wonder.
It's funny, we shot it twice, didn't we? This was we had a sort of a camera fault. And so we had to shoot some things twice, and I think we shot this very near the beginning of the movie, and then very near the end again. Jobs.
And that was one of those false economies where you, because we didn't have that much money, we didn't, we would shoot on film every day, but we didn't always, we didn't, and we would print. Well, the rushes that we would get to look at were on tape, so we would view what we'd done that day on videotape, and you couldn't tell that there was a problem on tape.
No.
It was only when, about a week later, when we did get some prints of that scene that
yeah, so you found it was all blurry.
Yeah.
Whereas if you watch a movie on VHS, you can't tell if it's blurry, because VHS is blurry built in.
Yeah.
It's the second appearance of the Nimrod theme from Enigma Variations, which I liked in the movie because I was looking for something to tie the movie up romantically. So Jed plays it in his funeral repertoire, and it happens here in the assembly scene because Kate's falling under Jed's influence, and it'll happen again by the end of the movie. I think Kevin's score was influenced by it as well. He uses some of the same sort of chord structures. Shock her with the truth about him. We'll have to outclass him. Bit of comedy hair here. I think the girls,
I didn't mind this.
Looked in the mirror and thought, how can we have comedy hair? Sexual intercourse.
Lovely hot bath.
This was the corner of somebody's room, wasn't it? I mean, we installed some bottles of Paul Mitchell product and had a couple of would-be hairdressers in the foreground. But essentially, that's someone's front room, isn't it?
Yeah. Just for the weekend, and I don't want the fact that you never see your
tired old spinster friends to influence your decision in any way. Molly! Andy McDowell with the strange Minnie Mouse hair here. Because
yeah.
There's a scene omitted,
like Star Wars,
by this time. Yeah, she's a bit, she's a bit Carrie Fisher, isn't she?
Hmm.
Come on, princess, save the galaxy. There was a scene that we've cut out in the final cut where she went to a rave with Jed, didn't she?
Mm.
Some of our test audiences found that scene unacceptable because the implication was that Andy McDowell's character had indeed tried the ecstasy that Jed was so in trouble for, without ever there being a drug-taking scene. It was just left to the imagination. Mm. And I guess the Minnie Mouse hair was kind of under the influence of that. I'm a great lover of cheesy Riviera movies where they have kind of bowling around in a sports car in France somewhere, sequences like that. That travelogue sequence is all about that. God, it's all in. Shooting in France was great, wasn't it?
I was ill all the time, but it was good. And I love the way that...
it was great for me, really.
I looked at the ceiling for 2.5 days with food poisoning. some dodgy mayonnaise, I think. But this, people might want to know, it's in front of Notre Dame, isn't it?
That's right, and, we're really there.
There
yeah.
was no restaurant. We built it.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it didn't take a lot of building, but it looks real to me. You know, I know people have asked, where's that restaurant? When we get lots of calls about where is this location and that restaurant and this place.
We should open that restaurant.
We should, yeah.
It's very popular. it was, we were all bowled over by the fact that we were in Paris and it was the end of the shoot, and the crew quite rightly judged these last two or three days as something of a holiday. So I think all these shots are very fluid because the entire crew is well oiled.
They were very fluid themselves.
I'm very fond of subtitle gags, so I managed to sneak one in.
Merci, monsieur. Merci, madame. Yeah, you're very defensive of all your gags. Quite rightly. Whenever there was an attempt to cut anything, it was like, yeah, but there's a gag there, and you...
Those things are rare as hen's teeth. You've got to keep them, Lee.
Exactly.
This French hotel room is actually somebody's house in Islington. Yeah. Somebody's done their house in this amazing French style. There was a row that day. I don't know if you remember. It wasn't really a row. It was a debate where originally the girls were meant to be running around in towels. That's what it said in the script. But there was something of a bloodless coup happened. And when I got to the dressing room to say, come on, let's go and shoot the scene, they were all wearing dressing gowns and told me that there was going to be no towel action that day. Mm. I think because they tried the towels, and a towel on Imelda Staunton made her look like a baby, you know, because it would cover all of her. Mm. But the same towel on Anna Chancellor would, like, either cover her top or her bottom. You couldn't you couldn't get both.
Yeah. So did they have those, did they happen to have those dressing gowns?
Yeah, I think the very clever costume designer had stocked an alternative, knowing that trouble was brewing.
What's wrong?
Nothing.
Sure?
Hmm.
I was wondering if you wanted to stay a day or two more. I have hours in the country.
Originally, Andy McDowell's character was meant to sleep with the Frenchman. Mm. And kind of, we wouldn't really see it, but we'd see her waking up afterwards very, very guilty. And again, there was a sort of a clash of taste between me, certainly, and our financiers. I don't know how you felt about it.
But no, I think I opposed them sleeping together because I thought it was just a step too far for us to buy her character. You know,
yeah, but why can't people make mistakes? You know, I like the idea that she would make a mistake and regret it, you know?
Yeah.
I remember the note from our financier, though, which said very simply, no, 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 no way can Kate fuck the frog.
I love you. I love you too.
I like that bit of music very much. I'm a sucker for the big romantic themes.
Nice time in France.
Not as nice as here.
We used to have more of this guy because there used to be more about the guys who ran the crematorium.
It's terrible.
Of which more later.
That's good. Guess there's something I wanted to ask you.
Nobody left till 3.
Yeah, that guy, Derek Deadman, he's been in an enormous number of films, hasn't he?
Yeah, yeah, good.
Hundreds and hundreds.
He can't fit them all on his CV. He's got a great face and is always very castable as little man.
Kate?
Yes, it's me.
Why are you calling from there?
This is one of our digital effects. Where we get onto a split screen. I mean, it's age old, you know, movie convention of a split screen. I was just thrilled to have one, actually. It's like, you know, my first dissolve, my first split screen. Great. Just like that. Though, I, never having done one before, I forgot to keep the camera still. You got to keep the camera really rock steady, otherwise the whole frame bounces around.
It took a while to get the colours right as well, didn't it?
Yeah.
I think that a lot of that scene was treated one way or another with the colour to even it out, so it wasn't.
Here's a bit of Nick Drake music. There's a couple of Nick Drake tracks in the movie, aren't there?
You introduced me to Nick Drake on this film. I absolutely adore him.
He is great, and, I mean, he keeps being revived and revived. I was determined that the Kate character shouldn't get married in dress, that she would have a white suit. That's an Armani suit, actually.
Mm-hmm. lot of the characters change their costumes a lot, but Jed keeps that t-shirt on a lot. What was the thinking there? Is it money?
Probably. Probably. Here's your t-shirt, Jed. Wear it. I think also you've got to keep characters, unless you're doing a special scene, you've got to keep characters wearing the same kind of colours, because there's a strange thing happens when you watch a movie. If a character suddenly wears a costume that is very, very different from what they've been wearing before, we suddenly don't see them as the same character. We expect that it's someone else.
You know that shot there? Originally, we reshot that, didn't we?
Which thing?
Just now of Bill falling over.
Yeah.
We shot the screen up close, and originally you'd shot a fairly wide, loose shot in which the TV was, you know, one tiny little piece in the middle of it, and in the middle of that was Bill falling over. Uh-huh. I always thought that was funnier, actually, because something about the, you know, the little person tumbling that was just made me laugh more.
Because it's subtler.
It's subtler.
Yeah, that sounds good. Can we do that again?
All right, then. But you thought that people were missing it, didn't you? It's like one of those calls in the edits where you think, oh, I don't want them to miss that. But
I know, you get nervous, I think, after a while.
Yeah.
That things aren't clear enough. And sometimes you can go too far. I really like the scene with them being contained in the letterbox frame and just letting them do the moves themselves. It's a little bit like the way they set up their scenes in Sense and Sensibility, the Emma Thompson, Jane Austen film, where they let the light come in from outside. That's real light. This is a real cottage. The door is really open. And they just let that light the scene.
There is a lot of choice. These have been very popular. They're a little bit more informal, but...
I don't know. I can't decide.
Well, matrimonial stationery is very tricky, Miss Gales.
I've never done it before.
Everyone has a first time. Mm. Tell me, does the groom live... locally?
Actually, he's...
This is my favourite costume for Andy McDowell.
Miss Gales?
It might sound a bit woofy to have a favourite costume, but there's something I really like about this outfit on her. Mm. She tends to be dressed in quite sort of pinky, florally things, generally. And talking of Jane Austen and Sense and Sensibility, I was very sure that I wanted a kind of... a tailored, quite restrictive wardrobe for these women, and particularly for Andy, because I felt that she was a very sort of closeted-up personality. So that long coat's just about the best of that.
Mm.
What an idiot! I really, really shot that scene badly. Someone's walking on their hands, and I didn't shoot their feet in the air. Can I have the money to go back and do that again, Lee?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, but you know, you get the picture.
No, the whole point is you don't get the picture.
Well, what do you think everyone's thinking, that he's walking backwards with his feet? And his
I don't know. I don't know what everyone's thinking.
Oh, don't worry about it.
You'll be all right. I should pay a fine for that. I like the bit where we come up over the hedge. There was a great big kind of seesaw thing that we used to get up over the hedge here. And, you know, I never got a ride on it.
Now, why was that?
I don't know. I was too busy being important, and somebody else got a ride on it.
Oh, that's lovely.
This was shot really early on, wasn't it?
One of the first scenes we did, actually.
Yeah.
This is a lesson in don't ever let a film crew into your garden.
Gosh, yeah.
Because this woman in this beautiful little cottage had this incredible overgrown country cottage garden, you know, very sort of wild, full of butterflies and... not a blade of grass cut for months, but it looked great. And, of course, we wanted to use it as a location. And the garden originally looks as good as it looks in the film here. But by the time a film crew has trampled round it and shot it from every angle, it's like, you know, the 4th Marines have landed in your garden.
And I remember thinking, I'll never meet anyone so gorgeous, so rich and so...
Even where Andy McDowell gets to in a minute with her character, you know, there's the falling out that's going to happen here. And given that it was shot early on in the actual filmmaking process, how pleased were you with to get the pitch right, you know, the right level of anger and the right... Once she sets this, that's the thing you'll be working to for the rest of the film. How did you work with Andy to get the right pitch?
Well, you know, we rehearsed, didn't we? I was very keen that we should have several days of rehearsal so you can go through the story several times. Not to block moves or exact performances or anything, but just to give them a map of how you feel at any point in the movie. And then after that, when you're shooting, you can kind of refer to that. Or you remember when we've done this scene before, so, you know, you're building up here, you're going to blow your top in a minute. You know, they've got some sort of geography of where things are, even when you're shooting out of sequences, necessarily you have to do in a movie. If this scene was, we spent a long time in the editing room in this scene. I mean, not least because it's quite a long scene. And I remember you and I having sort of debates about what was the best performance and, you know, did we really pull it off and did we need to go back to it? Or because she's going to, she's having sort of doubts about the love affair which we've been interested in so far. So that's quite difficult to play. And then she's going to blow up at her friends and that's quite difficult to play too.
I was beginning to think you'd gone soft in the head. Well,
plus, like you say, it was a very early scene that we shot, so the actresses don't really know each other so well at this point.
No, exactly, yeah. Of course.
I think we just about get away with it. You know, I think we get away with it on points here.
Roger spotted something younger and bendier down the youth club. Sure, he'll play at weddings.
And you're, you know, when you shoot a scene, you tend to... You would sort of do a technical block where you would go, you would, most people that didn't really need to be there would leave the room and you would go through it with the DOP and camera operator and the actresses and just walk it through but without overly rehearsing the scene. Is that right?
Yeah, I'd always like to rehearse on the spot before all the troops come in and view it. Some directors don't like to rehearse. You know, they're looking for something more live from their actors, so they think the rehearsal deadens it. I think the rehearsal reassures the actors that they know more or less what they're doing. And then when you start rolling the camera, you can change things and introduce random and surprising elements to keep their performances fresh, so they're not just trotting it out time and time again.
Reassures you as well, probably.
Yeah, for God's sake. Because probably I'm the most terrified person on the set.
And are you ever guilty of shooting a scene and then they say, right, have we got it? And you say, not sure, let's do another one, just because you're not quite sure whether you want to get another shot or not. You know what I mean?
I'm fairly sure that I'll shoot sometimes and not quite know what I want. But more commonly... you'll be shooting a scene and you think you know what you want, but it's not going right. Mm. And I can't think what to do, you know, because everyone's staring at you. Have you got it yet? I need to move on. It's time for lunch, all that kind of thing. And so what I do is I say to the actor, you know, that's great, but why don't we just do one where you know, you go a bit crazy, just do what you want. And the advantage of this is that it gives you about 5 minutes where you're not responsible for what happens to just... you know, get your head out of there and think up what you really want. And in watching what the actor does, they might do something brilliant. You might get that for free. But in the meantime, you can think up your next idea.
Meanwhile, a lot of people are staring at you thinking, haven't we got it yet? Can't we move on? We're never going to get home tonight. It's a real... who was it who said filmmaking is more athletic than aesthetic when you're actually in the set?
Yeah.
Was it Godard or something?
Yeah. There's a lot of running around and hard work involved. Not least keeping everyone happy. Here we come. Fireworks night.
I always worry why that flag is stuck like that.
Because we shot it on the moon, Lee. It's like one of those moon flags.
Why doesn't it fluff and ruffle and fluffle?
Well, it's just stupid sort of movie reasons, you know, that if we let it hang, there wasn't any wind, so it would just hang limp. which wouldn't suit the scene. But if you put a wind machine on it, then their hair would all be fleeing everywhere and their dialogue would be completely useless because you'd have big on it.
Probably a fire hazard with those fireworks.
Yeah, right? Yeah, everything would go all wrong. I like the scene because Imelda Staunton drives away like the Sweeney.
Yeah, she doesn't even check a mirror.
No. I mean,
she doesn't check much, and you just think, who's she going to hit?
Mm. This is one of the scenes where you get a sense of her as being a policewoman.
Yeah.
You know, she's done the advanced driving training. These guys were great. You know, we just used to improvise these sort of chat scenes with them.
Mm.
I wish we'd had room for more of them.
Here's the big entrapment.
Hmm. I like what Kevin did with the music here.
Yeah.
It's, you know, the theme is somehow ominous without your quite knowing why.
It's interesting as well. I think, Erin, your first draft of this scene, it was just Molly. I think previously Imelda Staunton's character said that she wasn't interested in going any further with this game, and Molly went off and seduced Jed, and there was even a scene where he responded perhaps more than he does in this one. But
is that right? I've forgotten that.
I think so. I think where he's really going for it in your very, very early stuff. And then I think the idea, we came back to the, no, if it's about three of them, then really Janine needs to be in this scene too. And perhaps if she's there as a surveillance character, then we'll feel less unsympathetic toward Molly and what she's trying to do, because it does seem to be for the common good, at least on the surface.
Yeah, I think it works that way, and I like Janine being in it because she sort of feels what we feel in the scene, which is that she doesn't want Jed to respond, and she feels appalled when Kate walks in at the end. Though the whole business of her being there and shooting a video creates a kind of red herring that a lot of people wonder about. You know, at the end of the movie they go, so did they ever show Andy McDowell the tape? You know, where did the tape go? People are very worried about that.
Yeah. I also remember when we were first trying to sell the film in Cannes, in the Cannes market, I remember having a discussion with one of the American buyers who... you know, she said a lot of nice things about the film, but one thing she felt very worried about was the human rights issue of this sort of what do you call it? The surveillance,
right?
Without
his rights are being violated.
Yeah, his rights are being violated.
Yeah, that is a worry, isn't it? I feel that Janine should have asked his permission first.
Exactly.
What a shite.
Kate!
I like what Anna does at the end here. It's very Anna somehow. That she puts herself together again and, you know, goes...
Cancel that.
Yeah, we won't have any more of that.
Digital shot.
Mm.
I'm telling you, nothing went on.
Big nothing. You were virtually up her ass.
Poor old Kenny. This scene was running a bit tame. I played a naughty director's trick and told Andy to really slug him.
You didn't tell him he was going to be slugged?
No.
And then you did take after take.
Yeah, we didn't go on too long, but it certainly added to his motivation.
It looks like one of those Hopper paintings.
Yeah, it does a bit, doesn't it, with very yellow light coming from
a
limited angle source there. It's not as if anyone really... In a way, it's too beautiful. I think it's almost like another movie.
Yeah, it does stand out in some way.
You know, like it looks like a Terence Davis movie or something.
Why shouldn't I have a bit of a fuck around if I'm too embarrassing to own up to?
This is one of my favourite shots of him in that doorway, with the way the geometry works.
Mm-hmm.
Triangles and rectangles behind him. I know that. I know that sounds poncy, but sometimes it's just a pleasing combination of shapes.
Mm-hmm. I think you get a lot of abstract geometry in a long letterbox frame like this.
Mm.
Somehow you see a lot of shapes in it. more than you would in a more squished up TV frame. The controversial Jed gets wiped away scene.
Yes.
I think...
Where do we begin?
Well, we certainly cut and recut and recut it, didn't we?
Yeah.
I think it's sort of right. It's right for the movie in that the movie is about the three women. It's not about. It's not simply about Andy McDowell's character and Kenny Doughty's character as a sort of romantic comedy. So he's youth that happens to them at a time in their life when they're no longer feeling young, and he sort of reminds them what youth is like, and then youth departs and they have to deal with that. But I think the lesson that I've learned is that people really like these two together, and they really, really, really want it to work out.
Yeah.
And that probably if I went back and rewrote the movie, I would work out a way for him to live, but pose a different challenge to the group.
You would?
Mm.
Because he used to say, he lives over my dead body.
Yeah.
And I agree with you all the way along. I think it was the thing that, you know, we were, even when we were developing the film, I mean, Film 4 were actually very good at not forcing us to do anything that we hated to do. But, you know, can't he live was one of the questions, and it'll probably cost you a couple of million if he doesn't, because for some people it's a challenge too far.
Yeah.
And the other interesting thing is that what it sets in motion after this is as much a problem in that the three women, how do they get back together after an event like this? And women are very divided as to, you know, I've been interested to hear the amount of division between whether they would buy that forgiveness or not. And like you said, did they ever show her the tape? And did they ever show Andy the tape of, Kate, I should say, of, you know, that it was a surveillance thing, that he was set up. Do they know he was set up? Often comes up.
Lots of people really, really blame Molly.
Yeah.
That somehow she caused his death.
Yeah.
And therefore that Andy McDowell ought never, ever to speak to her again.
Yeah.
But factually, that's actually not true.
No.
You know, Molly was being very obsessive and badly behaved and interfering, which precipitated a row between Andy McDowell's character and Kenny Doughty. And coincidentally, at the worst possible moment, he dies. But a lot of people are a bit more red-blooded than that, particularly Americans. I remember going around America with the movie and speaking to women afterwards, and quite a lot of women would say, well, I loved the movie, but I would never forgive her. Which explains gun law in America, I think.
This isn't how you make me cry.
Do you remember, actually, on a lighter note of death, do you remember that when the material we first shot to show him being dead in hospital, people... It was very sort of poetic and slightly, you know, not looking directly at wounds and resuscitation and all that kind of thing. And when we first showed the movie to a test audience, they didn't believe he was dead.
Mm.
They really, really didn't believe he was dead, because they didn't want him to be dead for a long time until they kind of worked it out, you know, 15 minutes later.
Mm.
So we went back and we shot more material to make it clear. And we shot everything that would say someone was dead. You know, we showed doctors kind of doing resus, shaking their heads, flat lines on EEGs. We shot a sheet going over his head. I mean, you know, we more or less buried the guy. And we put all that in the next cut of the movie and showed it to an audience. And that audience responded that, yes, they were clear he was dead. Would you stop going on about it?
Yeah. Why are you punishing us in this way?
So I guess
you shied away from it a bit, didn't you? Really, you know, the moment of
death. Apart, I mean, also there was a funeral in the film, which ended up being cut, so that should have dispersed any doubts. But perhaps you were just frightened not to look like any one of the other TV, you know, medical dramas that are on at the moment. How do you keep it filmic without people?
Yeah, how do you do a hospital death scene different from ER? You know, where ER has done it for 10 years, 100 different ways. I think in the end we reached about the right balance of information, though I do miss his funeral scene. We can talk about that maybe in a minute.
Except it won't come up, so.
Yes. I like this shot where we find Andy in the crowd. I'm a big fan of early 70s sort of American movies, the ones done by the outlaw directors, where they were using zoom lenses and kind of documentary practices. And there's something, particularly on a cinema screen, there's something good about finding her here on a long zoom lens. You know, she's sort of lost in the crowd. It's my puny version of something like the beginning of the conversation. People seem to like this music track. This was new to me.
Yeah.
Before the sort of tracking of the movie in the edit. I think it's one of the more successful ones that we introduced quite late in the process.
Yeah, it took you a while to get into it, really, didn't it? After what you'd had planned before.
What did I have planned? Was it going to be more Elgar or something?
Was it? Oh, yeah.
Or was it Joni Mitchell?
I don't remember now, actually.
Something gloomy.
Something gloomy.
Yeah. He's gloomy for you.
Yeah, now this was interesting because originally in the script there was a passage of time sequence which something was going on outside, the leaves were changing on the trees and all that, and we ran out of money, time and everything else. So I remember going away somewhere for an hour or two and came back, you said, oh, we've worked out how to do it, and a series of dissolves.
Actually, there's no dissolves, but there's a lot of motor zoom action here, where you slowly widen or contract the frame. And when you come back to the same subject several times over, I think you get the impression that this has gone on for quite a long time. It's a nice interior, that, actually, of Andy McDowell in the window.
Yeah.
It's like, again, early 70s movies. It reminds me of the interiors in Last Tango in Paris. Which, of course, is a very common reference for romantic comedies.
Absolutely.
These are the same dancers as in the Scottish Country Dance sequence. They knew barn dancing, too, and they all had checky shirts, so they came along and did this for us, too. Some people really twig it from that moment onwards.
But she's, there's something wrong with her.
Yeah. Well, there's nothing wrong with her.
No.
But for some people it's really obvious from there, and other people are really hard of thinking and don't get it. I guess that's movies.
Hello, Pam. Sorry. I think you know more about the gynecology of women than most men that I know.
Well, I can't help being an expert. Of course, in the original cut and in the script, there was a funeral before now. Because he was a funeral organist, of course he was going to have a funeral. At the funeral, the little men who work the crematorium are the only, you know, I don't have guests at the funeral, but the only people at the funeral. And they carry him in silence, and Kate watches. Because, of course, there's no funeral organist anymore.
Mm. And they played a game of cards on his top of his coffin, didn't
they? Yeah, because he liked playing cards. Nice scene, I think. But in the end, we worked out there was too much mourning already.
I think a lot of questions came up about, as well, about, well, where's his family? And, all, you know, people got worried, seemed to get bogged down with that question. So this was shot on nearly the last day, wasn't it?
This is the last scene we ever shot, yeah.
Miserable day, but perfect for...
Yeah, it was lovely.
What we wanted.
Lovely atmosphere. You know, because effectively she's saying, let's get married. and it couldn't be the gloomier, you know, a gloomier day to do it. England, eh?
There was a problem with sound as well here, wasn't there? Because we had them mic'd up, mm-hmm. and the pitter-patter of the rain on the umbrellas was obviously a bit of a bugger to get rid of. But
yeah, it's like the heels in the walking shot. There are always things that get in your road when you're trying to maintain the truth of performances.
I love the way Melda just looks around. You know, you really believe that she's been working here and she's checking everyone out all the time. She's just something the way she...
Yeah, she does a very nice double take there, too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
Imelda's an incredible actress, I think, because she has great technical skill. You know, she can stop on a button and do exactly what you want. But she has a real heart, too. I think Imelda is the heart of the movie. You know, she's the one with the conscience in the movie. Mm. I love this little woman's legs. That little sticks.
Not so much today, you're spoiled for choice. I just cannot decide.
Matrimonial stationery can be very tricky, Reverend.
First time for that, you see.
No, it's not. Back to the supermarket. There are originally a lot of scenes in the supermarket that, you know, the progress of Kate's despair. Here's another floaty zoom shot.
Hmm. Supermarkets are tricky to shoot from that colour point of view, aren't they? Because they just... Yeah. We didn't have enough time to go and say, let's move all those red, yellow, whatever.
I know, they're a nightmare that way.
Green bottles.
I think there's a lot of TV shot in supermarkets, and you wind up looking a bit like TV because of that, because the colours are wildly out of control.
You're better than sausages.
That is a line from my own heart, actually, because sausages are one of the things I love most in the world. So,
you sad fucker.
I am that man.
Now I know the inspiration from the film, yeah. Sausages.
I like this sound effect.
Which one?
In a minute. There. If you go back and turn the sound up, then there's a set of little Healy footsteps that are meant to be Imelda coming along the corridor that were added after the fact.
We have to stop her. He's not right. It would be a disaster.
Do you have issues with everyone who tries to get...
I think she's very, very good in this upcoming sequence.
Oh, yeah, she's fearsome.
Yeah.
She's ill. She needs help, because I seem to have heard this...
They're both very good.
Mm.
And the reference to the Sweeney. Oh, shut up. You've seen the Sweeney. Only half the audience, only the older audiences get that, don't they?
Do you think that young people have never heard of the Sweeney?
No. You were completely wrong. Not right in any way, shape or form. Just queen wrong of the bastard.
It's another way in which this movie is a fogies movie. That and the Bobby Crush joke earlier on.
See it.
Okay. As you say.
I love the little constable in the background of this. He's like a Muppet or something, with little eyes. Ah, the famous wedding sequence.
Mm.
This would have been shot over the course of... over the span of about 6 months, this scene, wasn't it?
Yeah. Some in bright sunshine, some in deepest winter.
Mm. Silly, really. And within the church itself, when we get there, there's material shot on three or four separate days, entirely separate from each other, because we initially spent... we gave it about a day, I think. It's my inexperience in scheduling, that we had really quite a big scene to do. Lots of... When you have a crowd, you have to get a lot of shots in order to get an impression of the crowd. And... we had to keep going back and back and back, and at least part of it was shot in a completely different church.
Mm.
We had to scour the countryside because we couldn't get back into the church in Chipping Camden. We had to scour the countryside for a church that looked a bit like it and keep the background out of focus.
Time. Right. Mum? You entirely sure about this?
Absolutely.
The guy who plays the bishop apparently used to be the Count of Monte Cristo on TV. He was a big heartthrob hero in the 60s on TV.
Oh, right. Let us stand. Love joineth us unto God.
I wanted us to really get into Andie MacDowell's head in this scene. And she's meant to be feeling fairly ill and queasy. I guess it's probably the biggest close-up in the movie when we start to sort of trip in like this. And I really thought I was going over the score, but I watch other people's movies and they're smashed right in there.
I guess over the top. When you say over the score, you mean you thought you were going over the top?
Yeah, I thought we were going too close at the time.
To love, honor, and cherish her.
I guess it's the influence of TV, you know, that more people more directors are making TV where you use big faces all the time.
And do you?
You've also obviously chose, well, lots of singles, and it's quite weird geography when you watch this, you know, between the three. It doesn't seem to be quite right, but that seems to help in a funny way.
Yeah, they're placed in an unusual geography versus each other, and it sort of divides them. I'd like to say it was entirely intentional, but I think part of it is inexperience.
The barf scene?
The barf scene.
That was not real barf. What was it? Ended up being vegetable soup.
Yeah, it was vegetable soup, that. We had a barf projectile device for a while, which was like a sort of pipe that was up Andie MacDowell's back and over and round by her mouth. But in the end, there was so much going wrong, so much fuss, and he said, "Give me the soup in my mouth."
And the Health and Safety Act, 1965.
I really love that joke. The Americans weren't very keen on the bar.
No.
The Americans wanted us to cut
the airlines
bar.
In particular wanted us to get rid of the bath scenes, didn't they? Because
they
didn't want people using those paper bags as they're flying. Or inspired to bath.
That was shot on a January winter day, and this was shot on a summer day.
When we shot that winter day thing, I was... because as you started to film, everyone had the condensation of their breath was coming out of their mouths, and I learned that the way to get around that is to stick an ice cube in your mouth so you lower the temperature and there's no more steam.
Yes.
Tell us about this scene, John.
Well,
are they getting married instead, the three of them?
There is a... Yes, there's a sort of... a subtextual element where she's saved from one altar in order to marry her true loves. Or it's a bit like Star Trek, isn't it? You know, where Jim is secretly married to Spock with Bones as the best man. In this movie, Kate is secretly needs to be married to Molly with Janine as a kind of both a mother and a daughter to them.
She has pain and nausea, often quite inappropriately. I always had those in the test of
patients. Again, I mean, here's one of those frames where, because of the widescreen, we're able to hold all three in one frame, and I quite like the composedness of that.
Mm. That said, and you know, one of the concerns about anamorphic was, but when you go for TV and, you know, TV safe, because when people watch it at home, it's still, they'll often get, unless they have a big widescreen TV, they'll get a compressed version of it, and... the worry is if you have the actors on either end, the far left and far right of an anamorphic, that they end up not being in the film.
Yeah, you have to watch out for that. That you can cut out your own action by putting it too far to the left or the right. Seeing as a lot of people still see movies on TV in that little square box.
Molly, I don't want to bother with this. If you could just refer me back to the oncology clinic.
She's some doctor actually, in that she can. Do a stomach examination through an Armani suit.
So, fill this. Oh, unless you want to do that for her too.
Do you remember we got real pregnant woman's real urine in order to make a real pregnancy test go blue here?
Yeah.
No digital effects involved at all.
I didn't know that until after the event, actually.
Yeah. Probably if you'd known, well, you would have got very worried because it would be like a biohazard to have on set. There must be some rule about that.
Yeah, I'd so worried about that with all the other things going on. That would have really...
really went blue on camera.
I'd say you're about 3 months, maybe four.
It's not possible.
Well, there it is.
I must be wrong. How would I not know?
She would know. We had a girl in here last year complaining of a stomach ache. Half an hour later, she gave birth.
I think this is the scene that redeems Molly's character.
Mm.
And Anna makes a very good job of this, I think.
This we worked on a lot in the script, didn't we? Mm. You know, you would show it to me and I was like, I still don't quite buy that they'd forgive. You know, she hasn't said enough yet or done enough to make me buy it. And we really worked on trying to get the right balance without it going on and on and on. But
are you kidding? My life couldn't get any worse of a plan.
Yes, people often do bad things to each other in films, and if it's the kind of film where nobody is really a baddie, then you need to have a "I'm sorry, I forgive you" scene. But if you have too little "I'm sorry," then the audience hasn't forgiven them, and if you have too much, then the audience thinks they're boring,
yeah,
and thinks you're boring too. So it's a tricky balance to get.
This is a traumatic scene to shoot, wasn't it?
Mm.
Because all the actresses had, you know, required a lot of sensitivity and they had to get themselves worked up for this kind of emotional...
Mm. There's a quality of stillness that came out in the scene, I think, because of that, because the crew was very respectful and it kind of got into the movie.
Couldn't have one failed marriage, had to have three. And all absolutely.
I know that Andy McDowell afterwards... She had the very difficult job of having to cry on the spot, and afterwards she couldn't stop crying for about half an hour.
Yeah.
But she liked that. She said, "Oh, it's great. I haven't cried like this for ages."
But deep down,
in some of the shorter, lighter scenes where she had tears, with other actors too, we would use the what is it? Lemon juice in the eye routine or something.
There are various ways you can provoke tears.
But this is for real, this stuff.
Something.
I have heard of directors with a long stick off camera.
Yeah.
Giving the actor a poke. But I never got that far.
I really am truly sorry.
It's a nice pair of balanced shots, this. And I really like the kind of olivey, beigey colour scheme.
And I want you to sign up for classes. I'm going to write you a prescription for vitamin B6 plus a general booster. You're obviously going to have to avoid alcohol and smoking.
Shut up! Will you just shut up, you stupid cow? And come here. I miss you. I miss you too.
It's Imelda who brings the comedy back to the movie here.
Sorry. I was quite badly behaved. You God, I was queen nasty at the horrid people. Yes, you were actually.
It's great because she, something about the way she plays this scene and bounces off Anna and lets the audience know they can laugh again after about 20 minutes in the movie where it's all been quite serious.
Drink gin, eat chocolate and talk bullshit like we used to.
Oh God, thank you.
I like this little end bit here because it's quite sort of random, you know. It's not really choreographed. They just made it up.
Oh, really?
You know, it's sort of worked out into a nice composition, but I didn't tell them to do that. And I think that makes a difference.
Did you allow for much improvisation on set?
A bit, you know. I mean, they've got to hit their marks and everything, but I like actors to make it up a bit because I get tired of my old lines.
I wonder if anyone saw the camera crew's legs in that window back there. If you were to rewind a second, that'd be the only
rewind
time.
Rewind and freeze. Yeah, the cameraman, Henry, was so pleased because I think he'd improvised a little trolley or something. He'd found a shopping trolley that he could do that tracking shot in. And he wasn't pleased at all when I showed him himself in the window. We had a bigger Christmas scene than this, didn't we? This is the last vestige of a little Christmas scene.
This was improvised, wasn't it?
But yeah, they didn't tell the sheet what to do.
Henry Braham in his jeep, wrangling the sheep.
Henry the cameraman is also a farmer, and we wanted to get some sheep and a bit of countryside in the shot, and the sheep wouldn't do what we wanted, so Henry got his jeep and chased them.
I love this part of the score as well.
Yeah, it's a nice song. Part.
Very imaginative, this bit. I love this as well, this scene. What a great idea, John. I'm not supposed to say things like that.
No, you're
DVD
not.
Things,
no, you're not. You can say it to me privately.
Molly! It's a boy!
Some people say to me, Molly's a doctor, why isn't she present at the birth? And my answer is that she's a doctor, she hates all that stuff.
Hmm. Not working.
Yeah. She wouldn't want to be around all that messy stuff. This was a real baby. Well, you can tell it's a real baby.
It's not animatronic, is it, John?
No, we did have an animatronic standing by. It's a bit of a rubber baby in case the real babies didn't make it. But when you have a baby in a film, of course, babies are born when they want to be born. And you can't book a new baby. You just have to wait and see who's ready on the day. So we got this baby at fairly short notice. By this time, most of the movie has been worked out. You know, the plot has been kind of worked out by this time, and they've become friends again. And there's an argument that the movie ought to end with them all getting back together again in Mona Lee's office, or perhaps at the end of that last sequence we saw, you know, where Kate has her baby. And for a long time, we were in debate with the money, weren't we, about whether we should end there. But I don't know about you, I always felt adamant that we needed a final sad Farkas Club scene in order to know that everything had changed, but something about their friendship remained the same.
And that was, for some people, it's like, well, what has changed? And that's this isn't the sort of film where, you know, they were friends in the beginning talking about their relationships and men and life, and the scene is set in the same way, but the way they're approaching their lives and their friendship has changed.
Mm.
And that was sort of enough of a change for us.
Can look at me and say a thing like,
I want to be in your pussy right now.
It's not often you get the chance to say that in a movie.
No. And it breaks the code in that he's the first guy to actually say his words.
Yeah, the other guys in the other memories are narrated for, aren't they? Yeah. It was just funnier when he said it, so we let him say it.
Well,
there's a nice piece of timing and mime between the two of them here.
If you blink at the wrong time, you miss that
blink
as well.
Yeah, you miss his blink, yeah. I like what Imelda does too.
Yeah.
Yeah, because she's like very uncomfortable.
But we can't.
These guys, I like the way his little finger moves there. See, if you rewind now, I love the way the policeman's finger just twitches.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's the sort of thing you start to notice after you watch the film for about 80 times.
I know. I see. We don't look at the action anymore. No. We look at the backgrounds and the tiny things that nobody else sees.
Yeah. I promise not to laugh. Oh,
promise. I did. Particularly in America, I got a lot of questions about what's about to happen next with Molly at the garden party, where people would ask me, so is that it? Is Molly a lesbian? Is that what the movie was all about?
Oh, right. I thought that was the final parting.
Yes. And some people sort of thought that was a bad thing because Molly's a bad character, and I'm saying lesbians are bad people. But I think she's someone who always thought that men were the answer, who in a moment of extreme stress discovers that men aren't the only thing on the menu, and, you know, has her choices somewhat widened.
There's something very artificial coming up, but it sort of works.
Which is what?
Well,
the spill?
No, not the spill, but at the moment, just coming up.
What could I do? So I just grabbed this woman and kissed her.
Yeah, at the moment of the kiss, suddenly the background artists just get wiped away.
Yeah.
They start walking away.
No.
Classic FM.
Kind of like it, but it's so unnatural.
It's very unnatural, isn't it? It just sort of seemed right to me that these two should be on their own in the end, and that the moment would be so strong with the music that you wouldn't mind that the people walked away.
At the same time. Because if you were just loosely coordinated, you'd have one go first and another one drift off. And then, but it was very sudden, deliberate, and bold. Yeah.
But I don't want you thinking that.
It was deliberate, wasn't it?
Yes, all completely. Yeah.
And is she, well off?
God, yes, she runs a private clinic in St. John's Wood. Why?
No reason.
Well, she does.
Andy McDowell's got a great cackle.
Mm.
That's a real laugh, you know. Not many people ever get to hear that because it's not often produced in a film.
Sometimes. I think he wasn't here at all.
This next bit, we were at some pains to get Jed back into the movie, weren't we?
Yeah, because in the script, technically, he was out of it, wasn't he?
Mm. And,
but in the film, in the tasting of the film, it's like, well, something not quite right, something missing. So, keep going.
Well, to some extent, the baby was meant to be his continuing presence in the movie.
And it was a horse once as well, wasn't it?
Yes, there were briefly in one of these sort of eco-warrior versions, he came back as a horse. But we won't go into that. And in actual fact, this thing is something that we discovered in the cutting room, was that we'd shot the scene where she was playing Nimrod to her baby. And somehow he didn't seem quite present enough in that scene.
Mm.
So I said, oh, we could... You know, she's playing the piano. We could cut to him playing the piano.
I think that was my idea.
Lee, I want you to eat those words.
I'll settle on Anne Sopel, the editor, if you like.
Okay. Okay, Anne did it. All we were short of was a little shot of him taking her hand. So we shot that with... I think we had Kenny's hands for that, but we didn't have Andy McDowell's hands. Or her suit. So we got the costume mistress who was still around to make a little bit of skirt and a little bit of cuffs from what was remaining of that suit material, and it was actually her hands that Kenny takes.
Shot probably a year after the first
about a year,
lot was filmed.
And here's to men. I like these end shots framed up in the doorway. There's something very sort of complete about that.
This was a digital close-up, wasn't it, this one?
Yeah, we shot was slightly looser and closer, we went in a bit closer.
Just stop that.
And the sunset at the end wasn't quite the right colour, so we did that. We redid that as well, put moving sunlight and things into it, didn't we?
There's my name.
Yeah, my name's not on for long enough.
Got as long as me.
Yeah?
Yeah, 3.23 seconds,
I think. Right? For the DVD, couldn't we, be on longer? Seeing as we've done this chat as well.
Yeah. Anyway. Don't know what to say now, really.
No. Well, we're kind of spoiling Kevin, the composer's last stand here.
Yeah. I should just shut up, mate.
I will if you will.
I want to have the last word.
Okay, you've got it.
Give me your love, and I'll give you the perfect love song with a divine Beatles bass line and a big old Beach Boys sound. I'll match you pound for pound, like heavyweights in the final round. We'll hold on to each other so we don't fall down. Well, give me a wink and I'll give you what I think you're after, with just one kiss, I will whisk you away to where angels often tread. We'll paint this planet red. We'll stumble back to our hotel bed, and we'll make love to each other till we're half dead. Maybe now you can see what you mean to me. Give me your love and I'll give you the perfect love song. Well, give me your word that you'll be true to me always, come what may, forever and a day. No matter
want me, and I want you to need me. Cause everybody wants to feel needed sometimes. Has the game changed? Have the rules changed? As it's getting older, it's getting colder. Cause everybody wants to feel needed sometimes.